We have a problem with vehicles in this game, so let's talk about it. But before we start, I do want to implore you to check out one of these channels linked to the side of my page after watching this video. If you haven't subscribed to me, that's okay, but go sub to one of these channels instead. Okay, let's get started. We have been talking about vehicle balance for the longest time since the game came out. It has been a back and forth discussion. The vehicle players felt that the vehicles were terrible, and they got buffed, and then infantry players got annoyed, and then infantry got some effective or even borderline overpowered weapons against vehicles, and vehicle players got annoyed again. And repeat that around another 5 more times, and that pretty much summed up the entire course of Battlefield 5. And while some problems may be inherent to the vehicles themselves, many of them are not, and has been systematically ignored, so this is what I'm going to focus on today. First, we have to talk about the vehicle spawns in this game. It is far from ideal. It is actually a major problem with how vehicles work. How Battlefield 5 vehicle spawn works is that you can choose which vehicle to spawn only after a slot to spawn a vehicle becomes available. In Battlefield 4, for example, there are designated vehicle types for each map, and they have a designated spot on the spawn screen. You can also change your loadouts when a vehicle is not available yet, and this is not possible in Battlefield 5. And this becomes a problem. Not only is it just an annoyance not being able to switch your loadout before you can spawn, it affects the entire balance of the game. Trying to spawn in Battlefield 5, and really even just in previous Battlefield, is always a race among your teammates. You just sort of spam the button hoping you can get into a vehicle. So there's little time for you to change to the most effective loadout for the map, and often you may be stuck with whatever you chose the previous time. Not only is this a problem for yourself, it also affects your team if you're particularly ineffective at taking out the enemy tank or plane, or you spawn in a staghound when your enemy team has 3 tigers looking at you. This brings me to the next issue, which is a problem with having too much freedom. The entire vehicle balance goes down the drain. This is especially true for modes with only 1 or 2 vehicles available. Many times I have seen players spawn in an AA tank on the map without planes, and for that reason it is fine, but not when an enemy team has an actual tank. It becomes incredibly frustrating to be on a team with the AA tank because your own tanker is ineffective and gets taken out by the enemy tank. This is also true for planes. So many times you have seen both teams just spawn bombers after bombers without fighters. The bombers have little to no incentive to shoot at each other, and it becomes a huge issue for infantry players. Another problem with vehicle spawn is the fact that many of the breakthrough maps have asymmetric spawn system. On Aerodrome, for example, there are 5 tanks on the British side when there are none on the German side until Sector 3. On Arras, there are 2 tanks on the German side with no tanks on the British until the last sector. On Wake Island, there can be up to 8 tanks on the American side by Sector 2, with 0 on the Japanese side until Sector 3. My guess of their intention of these asymmetric tank spawn system is to simulate an assault and to allow them to take possibly difficult to take objectives at first. Makes some sense in that regards, but having multiple sectors in a row without any opposing vehicles just make it a massacre. It is in those maps I can easily go 50-0 or even 100-0 while playing aggressively. And I wasn't even camping. I actually have a few videos of me doing just that, and it is really unfair for infantry players. Another problem that arises with these types of spawn is that they usually don't allow them to keep all the tanks they spawn in at first in the next several sectors. So in an aerodrome, once you go past the first sector and the 5 tanks get destroyed, the British don't get any more tanks for the rest of the game. Same for Arras and so on. And these create a mentality for the vehicle players to baby their vehicles as much as possible, because once they lose it, that's it. And what this does is to promote a really passive play, and long distance shelling as opposed to aggressive PTFO play. Then what can be done about this? First of all, vehicle spawns need to be as symmetric as possible. I understand that certain maps may make sense to have some vehicles on one side only, like the first sector on the Pacific on Breakthrough. You probably noticed that vehicles are not as annoying in Conquest than in Breakthrough, and this would be one of the reasons. For example, on Aerodrome, give British two tanks, but allow them to spawn in at every sector, and the German get at least one tank starting no later than the sector 2. And translate that to all the maps with this problem, and I think infantry players will be much less frustrated. Seeing a ton of vehicles on one side and none on your team is as demoralizing as it gets. This is like in World War 1 when they just kept firing artillery at the enemy trenches. It didn't even matter when they didn't actually hit the enemies. The constant bombardments and fear of being hit were enough. But some may say those teams with tons of vehicles are the reason why they could win in the first place. There may just be too much open area for infantry to push, so you need vehicles to push, or the map terrain is just hard to attack without a lot of vehicles on your side. But I will argue that this will be a map design issue, and the number of vehicles should not be relied on too much as a balancing chip for the rate of successful objective play. If Aerodrome or Wake Island 1st and 2nd sectors are too difficult to take without having 5 or 8 tanks, then maybe the problem lies in the layout of the map rather than not having enough tanks or planes. Another thing that can be done is to return to the battlefield four system, so the map will designate which type of tanks can be used and how many. For example, you just can't ruin your team by spawning a bunch of AA tanks only to find out the enemy has no business messing around. And for the sake of sanity of vehicle players, allow them to change the loadout even if vehicles are not ready to be spawned. Now moving on to another problem, which is most apparent on linear modes, and even true for previous battlefields like Battlefield 3 Rush game mode. This would be having cliffs and plateaus and wide open sightlines for vehicles to snipe at infantry across a map in their uncap. This becomes a meta when tanks are relatively slow in the World War II setting and are more susceptible to infantry rockets and explosives. And why would anybody in their right mind push up front if you can simply play as artillery, they can simply shell from really far away? This is way too effective without much downside. This is unlike Conquest, where enemies can flank and can sneak up to them. Because in Breakthrough, they are literally in the uncap, and there is simply nothing infantry can do anything about them. It does not matter if they land a few rockets at them, they simply go back and resupply. There will be some more counter for infantry against tanks in the next updates, when the bazooka and the boom broom comes, but even then, I don't think they are going to fix these problems. And what needs to be done is to apply the aerodrome treatments to the rest of the maps. There are a lot more cover, they close off some of the cliffs so you can no longer go up there. It is definitely a step in the right direction, but there are more work that needs to be done to further restrict those vantage points that overlooks the entire map. Linear modes need to have a different kinds of layout than in Conquest for these specific changes, even if they are based on the same map. Otherwise, you get loads of game mode specific problems. Another issue would be the low score you get for focusing on enemy vehicles as opposed to infantry. Trying to destroy enemy vehicles takes a lot more effort without equal reward. I can probably kill 5 to 10 or even more enemies on average in the same time and ammo spent killing another vehicle. This holds true for tanks and even more so for planes. The worst scenario would be having a dogfight with another plane, loops after loops only to have them crash or bail. You lose the kill and points and you just wasted several minutes of your life that you could be shooting at infantry. So why bother? And players who understand the principle of the prisoner's dilemma will do exactly what infantry players hate. It is a paradox in which two individuals acting in their own self-interest do not produce the optimal outcome. In fact, they are always worse off. Imagine the scenario I discussed earlier, when there are two bombers up in the sky on both teams. In the normal scenario, it would be beneficial to achieve air superiority and then you can bomb the ground. But the way the game works is that it makes no sense for a bomber pilot to shoot down the other bomber, since it takes a while to chase him down and may end up with no points if they crash. And if they do crash, they will just be angry at you and spawn in the fighter and ruins their day. So both pilots understand this concept and decided that they will just ignore each other and they can both carpet bomb without fear of getting shot down by the enemy plane. And this also holds true in the Pacific when all you see are planes with the attack loadouts. And ways to fix this would be to increase the incentive for vehicle kill. For planes, it will be necessary to implement the highest damage dealt means a kill for that player in the event that the enemy crashes or bails. I don't believe in last hits because it is not a MOBA, and it feels cheap to me that the person who dealt the most damage ends up not getting the kill, or the points. But that's beside the point. The score for a vehicle kill also needs to be increased. It often takes so much more effort and ammunition to kill an enemy vehicle than to kill a few infantry players. And I may be reaching here, but consider even rewarding multi-kills for a vehicle kill. I also believe that vehicles mean a lot more to a team than one individual player, so a vehicle loss should mean multiple ticket loss for the team. So if you can go out of your way to shoot down a plane or kill a tank, you are contributing much more to your team than just one kill. And of course, not all problems about vehicles are not the fault of the vehicles themselves. There are overpowered elements for all the vehicles when used in certain ways. And to give a few examples, HE shells on tanks may be too effective at range, their zoom may be too high to promote sniping, the input lag on the first person mode makes aggressive play difficult, plane flares may be too overpowered when dropped hundreds of meters above ground with no effective counter, their bombs may be too effective on ground targets, and so on and so on. But those have always been the low-hanging fruit for DICE to mess around with, and they still continue to do them. So at this time, I don't see immediate need to emphasize them. I wanted to discuss about things that have been entirely ignored when they contribute so much to the problem we have now. And that's it for the video. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. If you disliked this, hit the thumbs down button. If you enjoyed it, like and subscribe. If you feel extra nice, and ring the bell too. Otherwise, I hope you have a fantastic day, and I will see you again soon.